Hello students, welcome to my video on spontaneity of chapter 6 thermodynamics. In this video, I'll be explaining about spontaneity, about spontaneous and non-spontaneous processes. I will also explain why most of the spontaneous processes occur in only one direction in terms of enthalpy change and entropy change, at the end of which you will know what drives a spontaneous process in one particular direction. So, shall we move into the topic? The first law of thermodynamics, that is delta U equal to Q plus W, indicates the relationship between the heat exchanged and the work done on or by the system. Okay, it just gives us the relationship between the change in internal energy of the system with the heat exchanged when work is done on or by the system. Clear. It does not provide any information about the spontaneity or feasibility of the process. It does not tell us whether the process is possible or not. Clear. Remember that all naturally occurring processes, whether physical or chemical, will tend to proceed spontaneously only in one direction. Clear. All spontaneous processes occur in one direction alone. We all know the trees grow up. Their growth occurs spontaneously only in one direction. Trees always grow up, but they never grow down, right? Likewise, if you take the example of a gas, it expands to fill the available volume spontaneously. Clear? This is because gas molecules diffuse from a region of high pressure to a region of low pressure. Okay, but can the gas contract on its own spontaneously and occupy a corner of the vessel in which it is stored? No, it cannot do that on its own. However, you can make it happen by pressurizing the vessel to that extent when the gas molecules contracted to a corner of the vessel. Alright, now look at the second example. Carbon burns in dioxygen to produce carbon dioxide gas. We know. Carbon cannot catch fire on its own. Okay, in order to initiate this, we need to bring a flame near carbon in order to ignite it. But once carbon starts burning, the reaction between carbon and dioxygen would proceed by itself spontaneously to completion. And note that the reverse is not possible. Clear? Carbon and dioxygen cannot combine on its own to produce carbon dioxide unless it is aided by some external agency. Okay, one more example for a spontaneous process is that of heat. Flow of heat is always unidirectional, that is, it occurs spontaneously only in one direction from a region of high temperature to a region of low temperature. But the reverse cannot happen. Heat will not flow from a colder body to a warmer body on its own. Not only these, many other spontaneously occurring changes show only unidirectional change. Thus, we see that the first law fails to answer why all naturally occurring physical or chemical processes tend to proceed spontaneously only in one direction, but not in the other, even though energy is conserved in both the cases. Okay. So, as I said earlier, first law does not provide any information about the spontaneity or feasibility of a process. It does not tell you whether the process is possible or not. Okay, for this reason, second law of thermodynamics is introduced in order to explain the spontaneity or feasibility of processes. Spontaneous and non-spontaneous processes. First of all, let us understand what spontaneous processes are. Consider the combination of hydrogen and oxygen to produce water molecules. Suppose these gases were mixed at room temperature so as to produce water molecules, and suppose that you let this reaction go on by itself for several years undisturbed, that is without changing its temperature and pressure, say for 10 years. Okay, the moment you mixed hydrogen with oxygen at room temperature, hydrogen starts combining with oxygen to produce water molecules. However, the reaction between hydrogen and oxygen takes place at an extremely slow rate that you would notice no observable change even after 10 years, even after many years. It would be as though nothing has happened between hydrogen and oxygen. This is because the reaction between hydrogen and oxygen takes place at an extremely slow rate. Note that this reaction takes place all by itself without the help of an external agency. Clear? Now, let's look at the second example. Suppose you add sugar to a glass of water and let it dissolve in water all by itself, where you don't assist dissolution of sugar in water by stirring the solution. You would find that sugar dissolves in water by itself at a much slower rate. Sugar molecules started dissolving in water immediately when it came into contact with water. However, the process of dissolution of sugar in water takes place at a much slower rate. Thus, a spontaneous reaction occurs immediately when contact is made between the reactants. But it does not mean that the reaction should be instantaneous. Okay, it may proceed at an extremely slower rate as I mentioned in the first two examples. Clear? And note that the rate of a spontaneous reaction may vary from extremely slow to extremely fast. Clear? So, what's the definition for a spontaneous process? A spontaneous process is one which has a natural potential or tendency to proceed without the assistance of an external agency. Okay, you don't assist the progress of the reaction with the help of an external agency. No assistance has been provided for the progress of a spontaneous process. Once a spontaneous process starts, it will go on and on till its completion without the assistance of an external agency. A spontaneous process may or may not need initiation to take place. Examples of spontaneous processes which need no initiation are listed here. First one is dissolution of common salt in water. The moment you add common salt, that is sodium chloride in water, what happens is that sodium chloride molecules start dissolving in water immediately. Okay, so this process needs no initiation. Likewise, evaporation of water in an open vessel, combination of nitric oxide and oxygen to form nitrogen dioxide, neutralization reaction between sodium hydroxide and hydrochloric acid, and so on. These are few other examples of spontaneous processes which don't need to be initiated. We need not initiate these processes. They take place spontaneously. Okay. Now, examples of spontaneous processes which need initiation in order to occur are burning of coal in oxygen, heating of calcium carbonate to give calcium oxide and carbon dioxide, and so on. Okay, now look at the first example. Burning of coal in oxygen. Coal cannot catch fire in oxygen by itself. You need to initiate it. How? By bringing a flame near coal to make it burn. But once coal catches fire, reaction between coal and oxygen proceeds by itself without the help of any external agency to produce the product. What is the product? Carbon dioxide gas. Okay, now look at the second example. Calcium carbonate. You need to initiate this reaction by heating calcium carbonate. Okay, once you heat calcium carbonate, it proceeds to decompose by itself to give calcium oxide and carbon dioxide as products without the help of any external agency. Clear? So, these are the examples of spontaneous processes which need to be initiated in order to progress. Note that a spontaneous process is an irreversible process and may only be reversed by some external agency. Let us understand this with a simple example. Suppose a cup of hot tea is kept in a room and it cools spontaneously by losing heat to the surroundings. But we never come across such a situation where a cup of tea at room temperature becomes hot on its own, isn't it? If such a thing happened, then we would not remain in the room then. We would flee from the room, isn't it? That would be an amusing situation. Cooling of hot tea in a room proceeds spontaneously, but the reverse cannot happen without the help of an external agency. Only if we supply heat to tea, it can become hot again. So what do you understand from this? A spontaneous process is an irreversible process. Okay, a cup of hot tea cools spontaneously, but the reverse cannot happen on its own. Okay, it can be reversed only by some external agency. So you can reverse a spontaneous process, but for that you need an external agency to make it happen. Having learnt about spontaneous process, let us now concentrate on non-spontaneous process. What is a non-spontaneous process? A process which can neither take place by itself nor by initiation is called a non-spontaneous process. Okay, you cannot initiate a non-spontaneous process. It will not happen also. Okay, the examples of non-spontaneous processes are flow of water up a hill, flow of heat from a cold end to a hot end, diffusion of gas molecules from low pressure to high pressure, and dissolution of sand in water. Okay, if you look at each of these examples, you cannot make it happen. Okay, such processes will never happen by nature. You cannot even initiate such a process and make it happen. Okay, so these processes are called non-spontaneous processes. The driving force for a spontaneous process. We know that all spontaneous processes are unidirectional. Okay, spontaneous processes tend to proceed spontaneously only in one direction. All right, so there must be a force which drives a process in a particular direction spontaneously. Clear? This force, which is responsible for the spontaneity of a process, is called driving force. Clear? Let's now understand what exactly acts as the driving force for a process to occur spontaneously. A process occurs spontaneously due to the tendency of the system to acquire a state of minimum energy and the tendency of the system to acquire a state of maximum randomness. But the overall tendency of a process to occur spontaneously depends on the net effect of these two tendencies. That is, it depends on the resultant of these two tendencies. Okay, now let's understand how the tendency of the system to acquire a state of minimum energy drives it spontaneously in one direction. For example, we know that water flows down a hill to acquire minimum energy. Similarly, a stone lying at a height has a tendency to fall down so as to have minimum potential energy. Similarly, heat flows from a hot end to a cold end so that the heat content of the hot end becomes minimum. Okay, so we call all these processes as spontaneous processes, as they all have a tendency to acquire minimum energy. Now, look at these examples of spontaneous exothermic reactions. Hydrogen burns in oxygen to produce water. As you can see, since heat is evolved in this process, it is exothermic. Clear? Similarly, hydrogen reacted with chlorine to produce hydrogen chloride gas. Here, 92.32 kilojoules of heat energy is released when half a mole of hydrogen reacted with half a mole of chlorine to produce 1 mole of hydrogen chloride gas. Okay, likewise, 46.1 kilojoules of heat energy is released when half a mole of nitrogen reacted with 3 by 2 moles of hydrogen to produce 1 mole of ammonia gas. Clear? So we see that in each of these examples, the system moves from a position of higher energy to a position of lower energy. In other words, formation of products by the combination of reactants is accompanied by the release of heat energy. Okay, so we can say that in any exothermic reaction, the heat content of the products is lesser than the heat content of the reactants, since heat energy is released or lost by the system when the reactants combine to form products. Exothermic reactions are spontaneous as they are accompanied by a decrease of energy. That is, they have a negative value of delta H, which means enthalpy change. Okay, so we can say that tendency of the system to attain minimum energy, that is negative value of delta H, might be responsible for the spontaneity of the reaction. Okay, the enthalpy diagram for exothermic reaction is shown here, and from the diagram you can see that the heat energy that is lost or evolved in the exothermic reaction, which is the enthalpy change of the reaction, is equal to
the difference between the total enthalpy of reactants and the total enthalpy of products, as the total enthalpy of reactants is greater than the total enthalpy of products in any exothermic reaction. So, is it a general rule that spontaneous processes take place in the direction of lower energy? No. The answer is no. This is because there are endothermic reactions which occur spontaneously in the direction of increasing energy. See, these are a few examples of spontaneous endothermic reactions. We know what endothermic reactions are. These reactions progress with the absorption of energy from the surroundings. Okay, see, here you have positive values for standard enthalpy of reaction values. Okay, so you can see that 33.2 kilojoules of heat energy is absorbed when half a mole of nitrogen burns in a mole of oxygen to produce 1 mole of nitrogen dioxide. Okay, here you can see that 128.5 kilojoules of heat energy is absorbed when carbon combined with 2 moles of sulfur to produce 1 mole of carbon disulfide. In other words, we can say that in each of these examples, the system moves from a position of lower energy to a position of higher energy, as the delta H values are positive in this case. In other words, in any endothermic reaction, the heat content of the products is greater than the heat content of the reactants. I repeat, in an endothermic reaction, the enthalpy, that is heat content of the products, is greater than the heat content of the reactants, and this can be represented by means of an enthalpy diagram in this manner. Okay, here the net heat absorbed from the surroundings by the reactants for the formation of products in an endothermic reaction is found to be equal to enthalpy change of the reaction, which is given by delta H with the subscript R. And this is found to be equal to the difference between the total enthalpy of products and the total enthalpy of reactants. Why? Because in an endothermic reaction, the total enthalpy of products, that is heat content of products, is more than the heat content of the reactants. So, endothermic reactions also occur spontaneously in spite of their positive delta H values. Clear? So, we understand that exothermic processes are generally spontaneous, but some endothermic processes may also be spontaneous, which shows that lowering of energy is not the only factor that determines spontaneity. Okay, in other words, enthalpy factor, that is delta H, cannot be the sole criterion for predicting the spontaneity or feasibility of a process. Now, let's understand how the tendency of your system to acquire a state of maximum randomness helps to drive it spontaneously in one direction. For this, let us consider spontaneous diffusion of two gases into each other, which do not react chemically, in a closed container which is isolated from the surroundings. So, students, here note that we are dealing with an isolated system. In this case, delta H is zero, that is change in enthalpy or change in energy is zero. This is because the enthalpy factor, that is energy factor, has no role to play here. Since delta H is zero, we would be able to find out what drives a process spontaneously in one direction. The two gases, say gas A and gas B, are represented by black dots and white dots respectively. Suppose gas A and gas B are enclosed separately in a container by means of a movable partition. Now, if the partition is withdrawn, what happens is that the two gases begin to diffuse into each other, and after a period of time, the diffusion will be complete like this. If you just analyze the experiment carried out, you would understand that before the partition is withdrawn, if you were to pick a gas molecule from the left side of the container, you would be sure that it would be a molecule of gas A. Okay, likewise, if you were to pick a gas molecule from the right side of the container before partition, you would be sure that it would be a molecule of gas B. Clear? But if you were to pick up a molecule from the container after the partition has been removed, you would doubt whether the molecule would be that of gas A or gas B. So at this point, we can say that the system has become less predictable or highly disordered, or in other words, more chaotic. Okay, a disorder has set in, or in other words, the randomness of the system has increased. Clear? After the partition was removed. So the second factor which is responsible for the spontaneity of the process is its tendency to acquire a state of maximum randomness. At this point, let me introduce a new thermodynamic function to you, which is entropy. It is denoted by the symbol capital S. Entropy is used to express the extent of disorder in a system. Okay, it tells you how much the system is disordered. Clear? Now, what's the definition for entropy? Entropy of a system is defined as a measure of randomness or degree of disorder of the system. The greater the randomness, or in other words, degree of disorder of the system, the higher would be its entropy. That is, decrease in regularity of structure would mean an increase in entropy. Let me give you an example to illustrate this concept. Students, how do you sit during class hours at school? You'd be seated at fixed positions during class hours, right? But as soon as the bell goes off for an interval, you tend to go out of your class where you find students from other classes also. So, what happened? The degree of disorder or randomness increased in the situation, right? Similarly, for a given substance, the crystalline solid state is the state of lowest entropy. Why? It is because solid state is the most ordered state. For this reason, solid state is the state of lowest entropy. Now, gaseous state is the state of highest entropy, whereas liquid state is the state of entropy, which is intermediate between solid state and gaseous state. If we arrange solids, liquids and gases in the decreasing order of randomness, that is entropy, it would be like this. Entropy of gases is greater than the entropy of liquids, which in turn is greater than that of solids. Okay, the entropy of gases is the highest. Why? Because in the gaseous state, molecules are highly disordered. Okay, molecules in the gaseous state are highly disordered. So, there is maximum randomness in the gaseous state. That is why entropy of gases is the maximum. Now, if you look at the entropy of solids, it is the least. Why? This is because molecules in the solid state are highly ordered. There is least randomness in the solid state. That is why entropy of solids is the least. Hope you have understood the concept. Entropy, like any other thermodynamic property such as internal energy and enthalpy, is a state function. Also, it is an extensive property. Why? Because it depends on the quantity of matter contained in the system. Okay, change in its value during a process is called entropy change. Okay, this is represented by delta S. Okay, and delta S is equal to the difference between the entropy of the system in the final state and the entropy of the system in the initial state. It is also equal to the difference between the summation of entropy of products and the summation of entropy of reactants. There are certain things which you should keep in mind when you measure entropy. Whenever heat is added to the system, it increases molecular motion, causing increased randomness in the system. That is, when a system absorbs heat, the molecules start moving faster. This is because when a system absorbs heat, the kinetic energy of the molecules increases, right? For this reason, the disorder or randomness of the system increases. Therefore, greater the heat absorbed, greater would be the disorder in the system. The temperature at which heat is added to the system determines the distribution of heat in the system. In other words, it determines the average chaotic motion of particles in the system. So, what do you understand from this point? The temperature at which heat is added to the system tells you how much the system is disordered. Okay, it tells you how much the entropy of the system is. Okay, thirdly, heat added to a system at lower temperature causes greater randomness in the system. Okay, note that if the same amount of heat is added to the system at a higher temperature, what happens? It causes relatively lesser randomness in the system. Okay, from this we understand that entropy change is inversely proportional to the temperature of the system. Thus, entropy change is related with heat, that is Q, and temperature T for a reversible reaction as delta S equal to Q reversible divided by T, where Q reversible represents heat supplied at temperature T in a reversible process. Clear? If the temperature is high, then delta S, that is change in entropy of the system, will have a smaller value. Okay. If the temperature is less, then change in entropy of the system will have a greater value. This means if heat is supplied to the system at a higher temperature, then change in entropy will be very less. That means degree of disorder of the system will be less. If heat is supplied to the system at a lower temperature, then what would happen? The change in entropy of the system will have a greater value. That means degree of disorder of the system will be very high. Okay, so we can define entropy change as the amount of heat absorbed isothermally and reversibly divided by the absolute temperature at which heat is absorbed from this mathematical expression. Let's understand spontaneity in terms of entropy change. Certain processes do not involve any exchange of matter and energy with the surroundings. Such processes are hence called isolated systems. Examples are mixing of two gases on removing the partition and spreading of a drop of ink in a beaker filled with water. I hope you remember the first example. Okay, I taught you this example in order to arrive at the concept of entropy. Remember, since these processes are accompanied by an increase of randomness, increase of entropy, the entropy change for these processes should have a positive value. So to sum up, for spontaneous processes taking place in isolated systems, entropy change has a positive value. Now consider these spontaneous processes which occur in open systems. Cooling down a cup of tea and reaction between sodium hydroxide and hydrochloric acid in an open vessel. Since these spontaneous processes occur in open systems, obviously they involve exchange of matter and energy with the surroundings. So they are not isolated systems. Register this in your mind, students. They are not examples of isolated systems. They are open systems. Okay, so in order to calculate the total entropy change for these processes, we have to consider the total entropy change of the system and the total entropy change of the surroundings. And the sum of these can also be equated to total entropy change of the universe. Okay, total entropy change during spontaneous processes is nothing but the total entropy change of the universe. Okay, so note that in these cases, for the process to be spontaneous, the total entropy change must be a positive value. So to sum up, all spontaneous processes should have a positive value for total entropy change. Okay, the value should be greater than zero. It shouldn't be less than zero. Students, I just talked about entropy change in isolated systems and entropy change in open systems. Now, what would happen to the entropy change of a system when it is at equilibrium? When a system is in equilibrium, the entropy change would be equal to zero. Okay, why? This is because entropy for a spontaneous process would increase gradually until an equilibrium is reached. Okay, so at equilibrium, the value of entropy would be maximum for the system, after which there won't be any further change of entropy. So that is why at equilibrium, the entropy change of a system is equal to zero. Now, if the value of total entropy change is negative for a process, then that would mean that the direct process would be a non-spontaneous process, while the reverse of the same process will be a spontaneous process. So, to sum up whatever we have learnt about total entropy change, if total entropy change or entropy change of the universe is positive, the process is spontaneous. If the total entropy change or entropy change of the universe is negative, then the direct process is non-spontaneous. Okay, so and the reverse process, okay, that would be spontaneous. Now, if the total entropy change or entropy change of the universe is zero, then that would mean the process is in equilibrium. Clear? We can calculate the change in entropy of a reversible process by the relation delta S system is equal to Q system reversible divided by T. That means the entropy change of a reversible system is equal to the amount of heat supplied to the system during the reversible process at a particular temperature. Clear? Note that while internal energy change of a system is zero for both reversible and irreversible expansion of an ideal gas under isothermal conditions, the total entropy change for irreversible expansion of an ideal gas will not be equal to zero. This is just for your understanding. Now let's do a problem. Problem number 6.10, and this is already solved in your NCERT textbook. Okay, predict in which of the following entropy increases or decreases. So we are given four situations and we are asked to predict whether entropy increases or decreases in each of these situations. Now what is the first case? A liquid crystallizes into a solid. Students, what would happen when liquid freezes? The liquid molecules would attain an ordered state. So in this case, will the entropy of the system increase or decrease upon freezing? It will decrease. Okay, so answer for this question is entropy decreases. Okay, now read the second situation. Temperature of a crystalline solid is raised from 0 Kelvin to 115 Kelvin. Okay, now let us predict whether entropy decreases or increases in this case. At 0 Kelvin, the constituent particles of the crystalline solid would be in an ordered state. Okay. Now, when you increase the temperature of the crystalline solid from 0 Kelvin to 115 Kelvin, the constituent particles would begin to move. They start vibrating about their equilibrium positions. So, a disorder sets in, and in other words, entropy increases. Clear? Now, what is the next situation given? You are given a reaction, that is, 2 moles of sodium bicarbonate in the solid state decomposes to give a mole of sodium carbonate in the solid state along with gaseous products. Alright, to predict what the entropy of the system is, that is whether it increases or decreases, observe the physical state of the reactants and the products of the reaction. What is the physical state of the reactant? It is in the solid state. What about the physical states of the products? Majority of the products, that is 2 out of 3 products of this reaction are in the gaseous state, isn't it? So as you can see, entropy of the system increases as the reaction progresses to completion. Okay, so what is the answer for this case? Entropy increases. Clear? Now look at the next reaction given. Dihydrogen in the gaseous state dissociates to produce 2 moles of hydrogen atoms in the gaseous state. Okay, so entropy corresponding to this reaction, as you can see, increases. On the product side, you have 2 moles of gaseous hydrogen atoms, whereas you have only 1 mole of the reactant on the reactant side. Clear? That is, product side has double the number of particles. Clear? So obviously, entropy increases in this case. So that is the answer for this situation. Now let's do problem number 6.11. For oxidation of iron, entropy change is -549.4 joule per Kelvin per mole at 298 Kelvin. In spite of negative entropy change for this reaction, why is the reaction spontaneous? Okay, the standard enthalpy change of reaction is given as -1648 × 10³ joules per mole. Firstly, what data are you given? You are given the entropy change of the system and it is equal to -549.4 joule per Kelvin per mole. The standard enthalpy change of the reaction is given as -1648 × 10³ joules per mole. Okay, and the temperature is 298 Kelvin. Remember what I told you about direct process, that is a forward process when it has negative value for entropy change? The forward process or direct process would be non-spontaneous. Okay, but look at the reaction. It is a spontaneous process even when it has negative value for entropy change. We need to find out why. Okay, why do you say it has a negative value for entropy change? This is because if you look at the physical state of the product, you will find that it is in the solid state. But if you look at the physical state of the reactants, you will find that one of the reactants is in the solid state while the other reactant is in the gaseous state. So when the reactants combine and produce product, that is Fe2O3, disorder in the system decreases. Okay, that means entropy decreases. For this reason, in the question, it is mentioned that entropy change has a negative value. Clear? Now, what formula can be used to calculate the total entropy change for a spontaneous process? Delta S total equal to delta S of system plus delta S of surroundings. We know the value of change in entropy of the system. Okay, what is it? It is equal to minus 549.4 joule per Kelvin per mole. Now, what about the value of change in entropy of surroundings? Let's calculate it first. In general, remember the equation, that is delta S equal to Q by T. Since Q is the amount of heat released during the formation of Fe2O3 by the system to the surroundings at 298 Kelvin, it would mean that entropy of the surroundings would increase. Okay, therefore, the entropy change of the surroundings is equal to the amount of heat released, okay, to the surroundings by the system when Fe2O3 is formed. Since heat is released to the surroundings, you write this negative sign here. Okay, so at temperature T, the total the entropy change of the surrounding is given as the amount of heat released to the surroundings, which is nothing but standard enthalpy change of the reaction. Okay, and you divide that by temperature. When you substitute the values of delta R, H naught and T in this equation, you will arrive at the value for the entropy change of the surroundings at constant pressure. Since heat energy is lost by the system to the surroundings, you introduce this negative sign in this equation. Okay, now on substituting the values of standard enthalpy change of reaction and temperature in the equation, and on solving this, you get 5530 joule per Kelvin per mole as the entropy change of the surroundings. On substituting this value in the equation for calculating total entropy change of the reaction, you get 4980.6 joule per Kelvin per mole as the answer. Okay, as total entropy change has a positive value, the reaction is spontaneous. Clear? So with this, I wind up my video on spontaneity. Hope you are clear with the concepts dealt with. Thank you for watching the video.